with William Lee. This is his graduate student project, where it's a study that you worked on as an undergraduate.
I did.
And now it's your official graduate degree program.
Yeah, I've taken it on as my graduate, my master's degree project, and it's quite interesting all the things we're seeing and learning out here in this grain sorghum project.
And you're going to be simulating grazing of this, right?
Correct. Yep. We are growing a grain crop with the intentions of trying to graze it with livestock.
That's right.
In the late fall and winter months.
And this is part of a year-round grazing.
It is, yes. It's a step.
Because folks are interested in that now.
Oh, yes, very much so, especially with the cost of hay. I mean, heck, tractor, baler, or even just the cost to buy round bales of hay, we're constantly looking for ways to increase our year-round grazing and reduce our inputs on our livestock operation.
And you have found out, because you've done this at home, that it's a protein-deficient system.
Right, grain sorghum grain, which makes the feed. The fodder leaves do not make the cow days. It is truly the grain that is produced, the 100 bushel, 120 bushel an acre grain sorghum that makes the days. But it's an energy-rich grain source, and it's kind of protein-limited in relation to what the cattle actually need.
So instead of supplement them, we thought in your project we would grow your protein.
Right, go right alongside it, all in one.
Like cow peas or soybeans.
Forage soybean, yep.
With the idea that you improve it. Now, you had a really great idea, because one thing you've noticed is that by February, the grain's about gone out of the sorghum.
Oh, yeah, kind of like Valentine's Day. The old saying, everything falls apart at Valentine's.
So you thought that we grew these beautiful soybeans and cowpeas along with the grain sorghum, but we also have a summer slump about August.
Right.
With our cool season.
Our grasses, stuff. We get less rain. You know, it gets too hot for our cool season to really grow. But heck, I mean, you can see right now. I mean, this stuff was planted beginning of June. It's took off compared to almost mid July here. This is some prime forage right now.
Even. Along with the legume.
Along with the legume, exactly. Along with a green legume versus a, say, in the winter months or late fall when that is mature and the leaves are no longer palatable and it starts to decompose.
So what you thought you could, a great thing to do then, is let's start grazing it in August, let our pastures rest, stockpile them, because they're cool season grasses, let them stockpile all fall,
right,
late summer in the fall. And then you graze this all through the early fall.
All the early fall, start like maybe August on the early side. Through the fall, let your grass just really take off and stockpile in our fescue pastures we have here in Missouri. And you'll have, so all your pastures will be full of grass for the winter months.
So on Valentine's Day, instead of grazing sorghum, you'd be grazing your cool season pastures.
Exactly. And the quality of our fescue, like the leaf material with that thick waxy cuticle in Valentine's, February, is most likely to be a better nutrition source.
Right.
Versus the mature sorghum plants.
Mm-hmm. Which probably maxed out about September, October.
Right.
Through December.
Right. And right, so there before it gets killed by the frost.
Right. So you've modified your research to take advantage of that. So you're going to start measuring forage quality earlier.
Yep, starting around August, we're gonna start taking samples and go monthly after that to track the see if there's any change in the nutrition as we go on. In previous work, we've kind of seen preliminary data showing there's not much difference in the nutritive quality starting around November to February.
And then it crashes.
And it crashes. Then all the plants just lodge and fall over, and then it's not much to graze. But right, yeah, it'd be very cool to see the nutritive value of this nice green growing milo and intercrops.
So then you'll compare that to stockpile tall fescue.
Right.
The quality.
The quality and even the economics is part of my project to really see, are we doing a more economically feasible feed ration by doing this?
And you got a soil probe in your hand, so you're doing what also?
Also part of this project, we're taking soil samples to look at soil health data and compare that to different treatments of the 30-inch sorghum versus 60-inch wide sorghum or the intercrops to see what the effect of the each individual treatment is on the soil health.
And this whole study makes for some agronomic nightmares. In a way, with weed control.
Weed control, yes, that is. As I often say, the best weed control tool we seem to have is shade.
Yes.
But sometimes, and of course, even in this system, there's a couple of herbicides that we can use, but we can't get it all. Like water hemp, that's a challenge.
Mm-hmm. But now you showed though that having that cover crop, thick cover crop this spring helped with that.
It did. Oh yes, we had a nice thick layer of a hairy vetch and crimson clover that was drilled last fall, and we terminated that late spring, in middle of May time, and that was a thick mat of stuff, and we had great weed control, very little emergence of anything, all through June.
Now the grain sorghum is thick enough, you won't get too much more weeds coming through.
Right.
But in the corridor, you will. So the corridor, its role is really going to be to supply that high protein crop late in the summer, early in the fall.
Right, and exactly right. In a time when the plant is still green, mature, and maybe before those seed pods crack open and break in the winter months, mm-hmm. we might be able to utilize that as well, just the more highly protein-filled vegetation that is provided by it. Awesome. Well, thank you, Tim, for coming out to my project today.
You're welcome. This is a lot of fun.
Oh, it can be.
On a hot day in July.
Hot day in July, all this rain.
All right. We'll see you.
See you.